Good afternoon, students. I hope you all are well and safe. I, Dr. Anil Maheshwariya, welcome you all in TYBCOM SEM 5. Friends, today we'll see what is the syllabus of your subject, statistics. First of all, the name of our subject is Statistics 7. So let's see the topic of our syllabus. There are two units in our syllabus. Unit 1, decision theory, it has weightage 40%, and unit 2, small sample test, the weightage is 60%. Now let us see first what are the topics or points we will cover in decision theory chapters. First of all, we'll see the meaning of decision theory. So friends, when decision is required, so when we have more than one alternative or options, at that time we have to decide which option is best for us. But when we have only one option, then no need to take decisions, because when we have only one option, anyhow we have to go for it. But the question of decision is arise when we have more than one alternative or act. So when we have more than one alternative or act, then out of more than one alternative, which act is best, that we will decide using decision theory. Then we'll see scope and limitations of the decision theory. That means when we can use this chapter and what are the limitations of this chapter. Then we have to understand terminologies, because before going on this chapter, you should know what is meaning of act, what is states of nature, what is payoff, what is payoff table or matrix, what is opportunity loss table or matrix, and so on. So first of all, act means what? Act means activity about which you have to take decision. States of nature. States of nature are the things which are not under the control of decision maker. For example, rain. Rain is not under the control of decision maker, so it is called states of nature. It is also known as obstacles. Then payoff. Payoff means what? Outcome of act and states of nature. It may be in terms of rupees or units. Then what is payoff matrix or table? So it is nothing but arrangement of payoff into the rows and column, and we have seen this matrix chapter in SYBCOM SEM 3. So I hope you should know it very well. Then we'll see opportunity loss table. That means what is meaning of opportunity loss and how can we prepare a opportunity loss table, that we will see in this chapter. Then after this, we'll see what is inadmissible act. So basically there are two types of act. One act is permissible and another is what? Inadmissible act. Permissible act is also known as admissible act. So we'll see the meaning of inadmissible act, and again it is very important for your syllabus also. Then there are basically three types of method. Out of these three methods, we have to learn about two methods. That is, methods of decision making under risk and method of decision making under uncertainty. Now, how many methods are there under the heading of decision making under risk? So basically, we have five methods. First is maximum likelihood method. Second, expected monetary value. Third, expected opportunity loss. Fourth, expected value of perfect information. And fifth, decision tree. So again, it is very, very most important methods. And basically, this method we will use when in market risk is there and we know about the probability in well advance. Then only we can use this first method. Second one, decision making under uncertainty. So in this heading, we'll see Laplace criteria. It is also known as rule. Then Maximin criteria, Maximax criteria, Hurwitz criteria, Minimax criteria, and so on. So basically, what is meaning of Maximin mean criteria? So Maximin is nothing but it is a maximum of the minimum outcome. Maximax means what? Maximum of the maximum outcome. Then Hurwitz. Hurwitz is a combination of Maximin criteria and Maximax criteria. That means Maximin criteria we will use under the pessimism situation. Maximax criteria we will use under the optimism situation. And when the situation is odd, neither pessimism nor optimism, then it is advisable to use Hurwitz criterion, because it is a weighted average of Maximin criteria and Maximax criteria. So we'll see that in this chapter. Then what is Minimax criteria? Minimax is nothing but it is minimum of the maximum. Basically, this criteria we will use under the odd situation. Then after we'll see Bayes theorem and we'll see the practical questions of this chapter. Okay, so this was unit 1, and the weightage of this unit 1 is 40%. Again, student, this is very, very easy unit. That means if you want to obtain 20 out of 20 marks, you can easily obtain from this chapter. So my advice is to you that first go for chapter number 1, decision theory. Okay, now let us see another part, that is small sample test, or it is also known as testing of hypothesis part 2. Now we have started this chapter in SYBCOM SEM 4, and we'll end this chapter in TYBCOM SEM 6. And you can see that this chapter is very, very practical, and again it is very important in real life situation. When you want to run your own business, or if you want to start new business, then these two chapters, unit 1 and unit 2, are very, very important for us. So now let us see what is the syllabus of unit 2, that is small sample test. So again, the weightage is 60%. That means you can obtain 30 marks from this chapter. Okay. Now, first unit is t-test. Now, in SYBCOM, we have seen large sample test. Now, what is meaning of large sample test? When sample size is more than 30, then it is considered as large sample test. But when your sample size is 30 or less than 30, then we cannot use large sample test, because when your sample size is large, it is always follow normal distribution. But when your sample size is small, it will not follow normal distribution, but it will follow different types of probability distribution. So one type is t-test or t-distribution, or it is also known as student t-distribution. Okay. So now in t-test, we will see four methods. Method number one, single hypothetical mean test. When we have one sample, and if you have given one population mean, then we will apply single hypothetical mean test. In large sample test, we have seen the same method for single sample. But what is the difference? In large sample test, sample size is more than 30. But when sample size is less than 30, then we cannot use large sample test. Then instead of large sample test, we will use small sample test. Then independent t-test. Independent t-test, basically we can use or apply when we have two independent samples. For example, marks of the students is a one variable. Now suppose we have two samples of these variables. For example, marks of SYBCOM students and marks of TYBCOM students. Now, if you want to know whether is there any significant difference between average marks of the students of TYBCOM and SYBCOM, then we can use independent t-test, because the students of SYBCOM having different syllabus, student of TYBCOM having different syllabus. So basically both the students are not interdependent, they are completely independent. So here, for this type of question, we can use independent t-test. And mind well, first method was single hypothetical mean test for single sample. But when we have two sample and when samples are independent, we can use independent t-test. Then dependent t-test. When you have two samples and when they are interdependent or they are paired, then we cannot use independent t-test. For example, marks of TYBCOM students in internal exam and marks of students in external exam of the same class. So here, both the marks are obtained by one student. So here marks are dependent on particular one student. They are not independent. So for this type of question, we can use dependent t-test. So I hope you understood the difference between independent t-test and dependent t-test. So we'll see later on practically when we start this chapter. Then after, we can use t-test for to test relationship. That means suppose you have some relationship. For example, correlation coefficient R is equal to 0.7. Now, how can we know whether there is any relationship between X and Y or not? So to know that whether the relationship is there or not, we can use t-test. So what is the condition here? When population standard deviation is unknown, then we can use t-test. And when population correlation coefficient is not given, or if it is given, then it is always zero. So when population correlation coefficient is not given, or if given, then it should be zero. Then only we can use t-test to check the relationship between two variables. Then after, we'll see f-test. T-test is basically designed to test mean or average for single sample or two sample. But when you want to know the variation between two variables, because might be it is possible that when you take two sample for different classes, for example, marks of SYBCOM students and marks of TYBCOM students, might be possible that you will get same average or same mean. That doesn't mean that they are dependent or there is no relationship between two variables. So for that, it is interested to check the variation between two variables. So variation among the first variable, variation among the second variable, and then we'll, if we want to check whether is there any significant difference between two variances, then we can use f-test. So t-test we can use to test average or mean. F-test we can use to test two variances or to test the variability. Mind well this word: variance, variability, or consistency. For these three words we can use f-test. Okay, after this we'll see in unit 3, chapter number 3, Z transformation test. Now Z transformation test is designed or developed to test the relationship for single variable or for two samples. So when we have single variable or single sample, or when we have one paired sample, then we can use method number 1, that is test of relationship for single correlation coefficient. So when you are given sample correlation coefficient R as well as population correlation coefficient, then we can use Z transformation test. So now it is very interested to know the difference between t-test and Z transformation test, because we have seen in t-test also this method is available. So t-test is used when sample correlation coefficient is given but population correlation coefficient is not given, and if it is given, then it should be zero. But when both the correlation coefficients are given, that means sample correlation coefficient as well as population correlation coefficient, then we cannot use t-test. Instead of t-test, we can use Z transformation test. When you have given two sample correlation coefficient, and if you want to know the difference between two sample correlation coefficient, then we can use method number 2, difference between two correlation coefficient. For example, correlation coefficient between income and expenditure of Indian people and correlation coefficient between income and expenditure of American people. Suppose you have these two types of correlation coefficient. And if you want to know that is there any significant difference between these two correlation coefficient or not, then we can use method number two. So method number one, we can use when we have single correlation coefficient and single population correlation coefficient. But when we have two sample correlation coefficient, then we can go for method number two. Then method number three, confidence limits for correlation coefficient. That means suppose population correlation coefficient is not given, and if you want to find the limit of population correlation coefficient, then we can find that value of population correlation coefficient using confidence limits. Here we cannot find exact value of population correlation coefficient, but we can find the limits, that means upper limit and lower limit, within which our true population correlation coefficient will fall. So that we'll see in method number three. So basically in Z transformation test we have three methods. After that we have another chapter, that is chi-square test. Now what is the difference between Z transformation test and chi-square test? So chi-square test is basically used for variable as well as attributes. So when we have single variable, and if you want to test single hypothetical population variance, for example, suppose you have the information that population variance is 60. Now if you want to test whether actually population variance is 60 or not, we can use chi-square test. Second method, when we have attributes, for example, now you should know what is the meaning of attributes. Attributes is a phenomenon that we cannot measure, but we can feel, we can count. For example, honesty. We can count how many people are honest, but we cannot measure honesty level. So here, for this type of example, we can use chi-square test. So when we have two independent attributes, and if you want to know whether these two attributes having some relationship or not, for that we can use test of independence of two attributes. Then third method is test of goodness of fit of the probability distribution. Friends, this method is applicable when you do not know the exact form of probability distribution. For example, we have seen this type of distribution in F5ECOM, binomial distribution, Poisson distribution. So suppose you have given some frequency distribution and you are asked to fit binomial or Poisson distribution to this data or to this frequency distribution table, then basically we will use chi-square test, and it is known as goodness of fit. And the last method, that is confidence limits for population variance. Here again, if you don't know exact amount of population variance, then you can find lower limit as well as upper limit of the population variance, within which our true population variance will fall. Okay, so basically in chi-square test we'll see these methods. Then last one, analysis of variance. Again friends, this chapter is very very easy, and again very very important for the further study also. So when you will go for MBA or MCA, then again this chapter will come, because if you want to prepare your project, then and if you want to analyze the data of market, then we can use this chapter, analysis of variance. In short, you can say ANOVA, AN for analysis, OFO of and VFO variance. Basically, in analysis of variance, we have two methods, one-way ANOVA and two-way ANOVA. So when we have one variable and when it is categorized into more than two categories, for example, income of husband, and suppose this income is further categorized in more than two categories, for example, income less than 10,000, 10,000 to 20,000, 20,000 to 30,000, and so on. So when we have single variable and when it is categorized into more than two categories, then we can use one way ANOVA. That means here we are interested to know whether is there any significant difference between the each and every categorical income group or not. So this is one way ANOVA. Then two way ANOVA. Friends, when we have two variables, for example, income and expenditure, and suppose it is categorized into more than two categories, for example, income less than 10,000, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, and so on, and expenditure less than 5,000, 5 to 10, 10 to 17, 17 to 30, and so on. So here we have basically two variables, income and expenditure, and they are categorized into more than two categories. Then only we can use ANOVA test. So here, interesting thing is, you should know the difference between chi-square test and ANOVA test. In chi-square test, also attributes are categorized into two or more than two categories, and here in ANOVA test, variables are categorized into more than two categories. So how can we get the difference? How can you find the difference between these two chapters? So chi-square test is used for categorical data, or chi-square test is used for attributes only. Attributes means what? Attributes is the phenomenon which we cannot measure, but we can count. Honesty, love, feeling, etc. But when the phenomenon can be measured as well as count, then we cannot use chi-square test. Here we can use only ANOVA test. So I hope you got the difference between these two chapters. Now just look at this diagram. Again, this diagram is very, very interesting. In this diagram, the difference between t-test and ANOVA test is explained in well manner. Now see, here, when we have one sample, then we can use one sample t-test and you can assume this hypothesis. But when we have two variables, we cannot use one sample t-test. So at that time, we can use either paired sample t-test or independent sample t-test. Now, again, it is very interesting to know whether the given two samples are dependent or independent. If given two variables are dependent, or given two samples are dependent, we can use paired sample t-test. But when they are independent, for example, marks of SYBCOM student and marks of TYBCOM student, then we cannot use dependent t-test, we can use what? Independent t-test. Now again, it is very interesting. When variances are equal, then only we can use independent t-test. But when variances are not equal, then we cannot use independent sample t-test. We can use independent sample t-test approximation. But this part is not in our syllabus. So don't worry. Mind well just one thing, that when we have two independent samples and when they are having equal variances, then only we can use independent sample t-test. Then what happens when you have more than two groups in one variable or one sample or two variables? So when we have one variable and when it is categorized into more than two groups, we can use ANOVA test. When we have two variables and when it is categorized into more than two groups, again we can use ANOVA test. I hope now it is clear very well. Again, I am repeating. What is the difference between t-test and ANOVA test? So basically, t-test is used for one sample or two sample. So when we have one sample and when we want to know whether the population average is particular, for example 30 or not, then only we can use t-test for one sample. But when we have two sample, then we can use either dependent t-test or independent t-test. But when we have one variable and when it is categorized into more than two category, we can use ANOVA test. At that time we cannot use t-test. When we have two variable and when again it is categorized into more than two groups, again we cannot use t-test. At the same time we can use ANOVA test. So basically, in TYBCom SEM5 we have two units. Unit 1, decision theory, the weightage is 40%. Unit 2, small sample test, the weightage is 60%. So again, both the units are very easy and practical. So here in this semester, we will see more practical questions and less theory. So again, it is very interesting for you also. So I hope now it is clear to all of you. And if you have any query, then you can send your query in message box also, comment box also. Okay, so thank you very much. Have a nice day. And we'll start first decision theory from the next lecture. And please ask to your friends that still, if they have not joined Google Classroom, then please tell them join Google Classroom so that we can start our syllabus from the very next lecture. Thank you. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.